I guess you all once wondered what our society could be like, how it will change in the future, and whether the course of change might lead to some societal construct that stands out of recognition to our current comprehension and practical morals. Thinking such thoughts, and knowing that they are indeed only fiction or at least will stay so for a long time, is very valuable for society today, as it enables us to recognize changing elements that could tip into a dreadful spiral of totalitarianism or dystopia, and work against those, and also give us a direction in which we can look forward and determine the steps necessary for both ourselves, the individual, and our environment, the society as a whole, as an emergent entity, to achieve a better future, which will be characterized by what we could nowadays call utopian traits. An utopia is the imagination of an ideal world, imagined insofar as that the term itself implies that such a world can never exist, as it is too good to be true. It has been described countless times since the antique, with Plato's The Republic being the very first novel known today to describe an ideal society. The story takes place in the city of Kallipolis, in which elected philosophers rule over the state. I don't think that any one of us would call Plato's description an utopia today, as the heavy 2,000 years that lie between our perceptions didn't just shape but recasted our ideals and goals thoroughly. Plato wanted the society to be split into castes that are determined whilst being a child upon one's performance in school, rendering those who perform badly practically voiceless, and those who could become star philosophers on their own getting elevated in the guardian caste, which would be allowed toward the philosopher dictators. Also, philosophers provided as marriage and reproduction should be organized by the state in a certain sort of eugenics program, also performing infanticide on those who are offspring of phenotypically weak parents. To top it off, Plato intended about 2 slaves per household, which were outlaws or war prisoners, to perform unpleasant tasks. To us today, this description rather reminds of a characteristic dystopia, the opposite of a utopia, as there is vast unfairness in the society and processes are inefficient and rigid, as there is an immense bureaucratic superstructure. A dystopia is generally described by those elements, but also through the characteristic of totalitarianism, that is arbitrariness, lack of free expression, self-actualization, summarized the complete rule upon the individual. In authors of the 20th century, those values tend to make up the dystopia much more than the quality of living, environmental degradation or well-being on the expense of others. The thoughts you construct are, after all, thoughts that spring from the mind of an individual which puts itself over the environment around it. So while you can have a dystopia whilst living in a pleasant place like in Brave New World or The Republic, you didn't achieve an utopia by simply abandoning all rule and obligations, which wouldn't stop you from becoming unhappy or short on food. A very important role in utopian society is naturally played by the members in it. How they behave, how much love they are able to express, how developed their sense of morals and justice are, or how much of the workforce they provide to society. If the productive strength development didn't completely eradicate the need to perform labor whatsoever. Human individuals are formed by the environment, which makes it therefore difficult to achieve a circumspected society out of individuals that originate from bad living conditions. Many movements try to reach such an utopia-like state, with the most significant the attempts on communism in the past centuries. The people couldn't quite achieve an utopian classless society, as with revolutionary, egocentric and stubborn leaders, the military pressure exerted by the imperialist West and the struggle against the expanse of the communist order around the globe. The description of an utopia that should be achieved at the present non-fictional world is what is called a constructive utopia, as it illuminates the steps necessary to reach it. Then there is the descriptive utopia, which amplifies current or possible trends into insane utopia, therefore showing us in which direction our society might be heading. This genus is often filed by dystopian literature and others, as it tries to warn and polarize us. Finally, there is the evasive utopia, which allows us to comfortably escape reality and diving into a dreamed world that doesn't find to have any connections to reality. Examples for those three genera of utopia can be found in all human periods and in all forms, not only literature, but also visual arts. There are several kinds of utopia, which I also want to talk about using the works of important utopists, and in particular the essence. In 1516, the lawyer, humanist author, and later Lord Chancellor Thomas More published this prominent novel, Utopia, that's the title, in which he illustrated his idea of a perfect society, which stood in contrast to the contemporary European and its particular Britain order. In the first part of the book, he composed an extensive critique of them to then counter with his imagination of the ideal island utopia, which was described to him, he himself showed up in his book, often being ironic, by a sailor who lived in Utopia for a while. On the island, a work duty for grown men and women of 6 hours a day is mandatory. The produced goods can be obtained without monetary compensation and according to the needs of the individual. An union of 30 families, that are organized in a classic patriarchal manner, is administrated by an one-year elected abbot, the Phylarch. Those groupations live together in a monastery kind of organization, whilst being secular and tolerant to all religions. Reproductive work is distributed evenly, and taking meals is a central communal aspect of the day. The government is democratically elected, with each city having a disposable lifelong elected leader. Also, private property is abolished. The title of his book originates from the Greek utopia, which can be translated as non-existent place. The Greek prefix u with an e, which is phonetically identical with the u without an e in English, does in contrast translate to nice or beautiful. This keen feature, but also the success of More's book, led to Utopia soon becoming synonymous. Vasco de Quiroga, who was inspired by the work of More, insisted to establish the system described in Utopia in the region of Micoacán, of which he was the first colonial bishop under the Spanish crown. In the Colegio, indigenous people of today's Mexico received free education in various sciences, in societal organization and self-government. They worked for 6 hours a day and lived without commerce. Each larger city became a center for a certain industry which interchanged goods with neighboring cities. Quiroga's efforts were very successful and he was said to be greatly beloved by the members of his flock. The island More imagined to be infinitely far away apparently became reality a mere 20 years after its first description, therefore voiding the non-existence of Utopia. More was hanged 2 years prior to the establishment of Quiroga's order, so unfortunately he couldn't correspond with him about his views any more. With the industrialization and productive strength development, but also the exploitation of the working classes in the 19th century, many authors and artists created vision of the machine feeding on its operator, or the machines being controlled by the headmaster elite, oppressing the masses with productive forces, with a prominent example being the 1920s silent movie Metropolis by Fritz Lang, a German Weimar Republic expressionist, in which he portrays a polarized class society in a futuristic and industrial setting. With the technological development, the oppressing and controlling instruments became more sophisticated, which prepared the soil for the growth of the totalitarian dystopia described in George Orwell's 1984. Imprinted by the industrial mass genocide and warfare of the Second World War, Orwell designed a truly lugubrious scenery when the novel was published in 1949. In his timeline, World War III broke out soon after, leaving only three major powers on the globe. The story takes place in the nation of Oceania, which fights a perpetual war against the other two superpowers over the territory of Africa and the Middle East. The war isn't about the resources or the territory, but it's only for its own sake. It is a sink in which excess production capacity can be exhausted, also depleting the workers of Oceania for no real purpose. The rulers of INGSOC, the ruling party, built an extremely propagandistic machinery, which blurs reality and makes it indistinguishable from false information. Having the monopoly on truth, it is widely accepted that war is peace and ignorance is strength, or that 2 plus 2 equals 5, as it is dictated by the party. With the introduction of Newspeak, which should supersede the old classic English, words like freedom are completely left behind as an empty shell in the collective memory. The word warm is replaced by uncold, etc. This linguistic pruning should exceed to disable free thinking of the population because you need a language to think in. By the way, scientific results showed that that's not the case actually. Often there are shortages in food rationing, as most of the production capacity is dedicated to supply the warfare. Thought crimes are highly illegal and result in torture and brainwashing. A thought crime is thinking or saying something that reveals the search to self-actualization, intimate relationships, arts, etc., or goes against the rule of the Big Brother, and is more often found in the case of the outer party circle, which consists of officials of the states and do have an elevated niveau of education, they're heavily spied upon by the inner party circle, 2% of the population, as they aren't exactly in good living conditions while being estimated as smart enough to plan an insurrection against the party rule, the Big Brother. The proles, or proletarians, which make up 80% of the population, are disregarded as too ignorant to reasonably threaten the party's rule. The excessive surveillance apparatus illustrated in the novel, which drains the population from any privacy, can be compared to the capabilities of today's intelligence agencies, which made at least one aspect of Orwell's vision come true. This may make you thinking, how can I know if I am living inside a dystopia? How can I know what is the truth? Good question, but that one is too meta to be answered. Another important work is Aldous Huxley's Brave New World, which was published in 1932. After Big War in the far future, the newly established worldwide government wanted to eliminate misery once for all, and started to establish hatcheries and conditioning centers where humans are breeded outside the womb in controlled laboratories. The societal case in which the embryos will be allocated according to the current needs is predetermined. Humans of the higher castes, Alpha and Beta, are educated and conditioned to become leaders and thinkers. Those of the lower castes, Gamma to Epsilon, are disadvantaged while being in the embryo state by getting a deficient amount of oxygen or getting alcohol mixed in the blood serum to remain unintelligent in the later life. After birth, classical conditioning is applied to unlearn emotional behavior or connectedness to the nature. Positive emotions are linked to the society, the caste one was born in, and sexual and consumerist pleasures. In the Brave New World, promiscuity and orgies are desired, whilst romantic relationships are seen as a threat to society. The mantra, ending is better than mending, reinforces consumeristic behavior, as produced goods have to be consumed, as having no work does indeed make unhappy regardless how wealthy one is. Then there's the stimulant and mood enhancer soma, which is widely consumed by the society. Aging doesn't occur and one is healthy until death, which is conditioned to be a good thing in child state. On first glance, it seems to be a perfect society, where the humans are desireless and not able to express and feel any strong emotions and don't have a goal in life, but rather only live a happy and uniformal life. Although many interpret Huxley's work as a dystopia, the people are indeed happy and the government isn't repressive, although totalitarian. They act of their free will, even when their personality was formed in industrial facilities. An inhabitant of the few reservoirs, where humans still reproduce naturally and aren't indoctrinated, commits suicide in the end of the novel, as he can't handle the lifestyle of modern humanity. He is the nearest to a present-day individual in the book and projects today's general ethic views inside the plot. Inside the plot. A last example of a technological utopia is the widely known Star Trek series. In its society, the need to labor is an overcome one, energy is infinite, and peace under the peoples is established. The humans work together in a sort of space communism, where totalitarian elements are avoided and the Starfleet captain is of integrity and solid morals. Now we want to ask ourselves the following question. Isn't dystopia always also an utopia? For example, Plato's The Republic is a utopia for the philosophers of the time, but includes slavery and birth control. And in 1984, the 2% of the inner circle enjoy a quite okay style of living. If you define an utopia as the good life for everyone, Brave New World definitely falls in the pattern and 1984 doesn't. If you define it as the individual is able to do how it pleases and it gets helped by the society and lives in material abundance, Star Trek and fully automated luxury gate space humanism falls into the pattern. The requirements humanity has to satisfy to transform human utopia inevitably enables the need for a totalitarian control, which prunes the rights of the individual. Therefore, before a utopia is reached, it really needs to go through a dystopian phase and, depending on who you ask, will always remain in that phase, leading to revolution, re-education, etc. The utopia of the modern world should point out the direction we have to steer in to overcome our current problems like the climate crisis, depletion of the planet, the capitalist exploitation and societal discrimination. Reaching them will be fascinating, possibly involving our newest technology, space traveling, transhumanism or elevated levels of awareness. Missing them could lead us into a dreadful, sinister dystopia. But no matter what our future will evolve into, our lives will be, hopefully, go on and be a valuable good to a lot of us. To stand up for a better world or to lapse into conformity. Thank you for watching this video. I hope you enjoyed and learned something about ethics, I guess. Thanks for listening to me.